Now we will continue with close friend of mine, Ise, Rosh Sam Ismail. Ise used to be my main competitor in collecting these stupid sneakers, but somehow we are over with that, okay, Ise? Ise has been active and engaged not only with the collective and alternative art space in KL, in Malaysia, but also in the region. Like personally, he travels a lot to the regions and build his own personal or even institutional networks since I think you were already here 2004. So since 2004, I've been watching him like popping out and off, on and off in many different art events, artist collective networks in Singapore, KL, Thailand, Jakarta, Bandung, Jogja. So we would like to hear your stories, Ise, please.
Okay, thank you for coming today. My name is, my full name is quite long, Rosli Syam Ismail, but just call me Ise. It's more easy. Actually, when people invite me to do talk about artist collective, actually I don't know actually what is it. What I'm doing is an artist collective or whatever thing that. So maybe we have images or maybe we don't have images. It depends on the story that I will tell you today. Actually Parking Project is just an idea. Actually, there's nothing really base thing. It's just an idea that I have this idea like 12 years ago when I come to Malaysian art scene, and I start to feel that, sorry to say that some Malaysian people here, that our art scene is super boring actually. And then I don't know, Mak Mela already been there actually. And then it's really tough for me actually, like to work in Malaysia, but I still working. And then I'm stuck with the whole thing. I cannot go anywhere. Like, no, I go to the gallery and gallery say like, oh, your work is not commercial enough to show at our gallery or something. So I'm stuck with the thing. And then one day that I meet this curator from Germany, and then he said like, oh, if this kind of work that you do, for sure you have no space in Malaysia. That okay, but nobody want to show your work. And then I say, so where should I go? And then he said like, you should go outside. And then I don't even have a passport at that time. And then he said like, yes, go to maybe Bangkok at that time. So what I'm doing is that I just work, do everything, like paint people house and everything, collect money. And then I got like 600 ringgit, and then enough to buy train ticket. So I take my first journey, like travel to Bangkok by train to Bangkok, and then to see the exhibition there. And the exhibition is organized by Project 304 in Bangkok. And then I start to meet people in Bangkok, and then like Jeff, one of the curators in Bangkok, told me about, you cannot walk alone. He said like, you have to, actually that, she told me that in Southeast Asia, there's a, like a train, there's a coach, like, she told me that there's a Cemeti there in Jogja, Ruang Rupa in Jakarta, and then like, at that time, a big sky mining. You have to do something like to hook with this coach, to moving forward. And then I just realized there's nothing happening in Malaysia at that time. And then,
sorry to interrupt you, but can we let go pass?
I think we are
ready.
Sampai di mana tadi ya?
You just mentioned something about Bangkok.
Okay.
And about how to join the wagon.
Okay, join the wagon. Okay. So when I just realized there's nothing happening in Malaysia at that time, and then I also don't have money to do something big or everything. So I just decided, like, okay, what can I do is like, because at that time I also, same like other people in Malaysia, we always angry to our National Art Gallery. We go there, oh, you are suck because you are not helping us. But at the end, I just realized that I waste a lot of energy because of angry. So I waste a lot of energy, and then I think like, I don't want to waste my energy by be angry. So I just want to do something, small thing. So I start, I say, okay, I rent a small house in KL, and then I call it parking project. Because I think that's the place that I want people to park. And then, yeah, the only thing that I can offer is like one guest room. That's the only thing. I just offer hospitality. But at the same time, I still don't have any networking actually. And then the jackpot coming, like I've been invited by Ruang Rupa in 2004.
Jackpot. The jackpot.
Yeah. Because for me, it's still like, everywhere I go, I still like, when people ask me like, you graduate from which school? I say, I'm graduate from Ruang Rupa. Because I learned a lot from them rather than my own art school actually. Because I'm coming from really orthodox art school, really conventional. So when I went to Ruang Rupa, it's really culture shock for me. Like, first night I arrived, like, we go to party at park in one of the club. And then start to meet many people. And then I never see this kind of fluidity in the Malaysian art scene. Like people from the music scene hang out together, and then it's really shocking me. And then as a coming from the very conventional school, I said, where should I work? Where should I do drawing? And then there's no place for drawing. Like, but the end of the day, like every day, like we just wake up in the morning and have coffee and just discuss. The whole month of like discussion. But what happens like when the, but I know that we have an exhibition at the end of the project, but it's really shocking me like when the next day is the exhibition, like, but at that night, like, everybody like just can do anything, and then that's our work. And then it's really surprised me about, and I learned something about the process is really important in the whole thing. So, and also friendship. So I go back to Malaysia, and then I think like, yeah, I want to be more serious about parking project in my own way. So I hijacking Ruang Rupa networking to start the parking project, because I start to know that people traveling from Europe wherever way, and but just stop in Kuala Lumpur for one day to see the Twin Tower, and then they go to Jakarta, and then I say it's quite wasted, because I cannot blame them, because maybe it's really boring actually. So through this kind of Ruang Rupa networking, what I'm doing is like I know people who are coming to this part of the world. So I start hijacking people. Like I offer them like, hey, why not? Like I offer you accommodation, free accommodation for at least like 4 days before you fly to Jakarta or Jogja. And then just come, I become a tour guide. I just want to show you around, to show you, to bring you to the best place to eat or everything. So that's how you start. Like we call it friendship networking. And then like the first guest that I got is actually coming from Gustav from the Bandung, from Bandung. So he's the one who sent me, like, he said, hey, he said there's one friend from Australia coming, so can she stay at the place? I said, yeah, why not? And so she's the first guest coming, and then, yeah, that's, I say, at the time I said, yeah, oh, parking space. The project is just parking space. And then the second guest coming is Anki. Anki coming, and then we have like good time at the time. And then Anki said like, if you put parking space, it's become big responsibility for you. We're talking about space. It's like space is more like existing thing. And then why not like we change it to become a parking project? So a project is more easy, like I can do anything that I want by the name of the project rather than a space. So yeah, at that night we decide to change from the parking space to become a parking project. So, and then, yeah, after that I start, because I have a chance as an artist to do project like not around the world, but a lot. So I start to collecting friend, actually, like collecting friend, and then these people, like, yeah, I know that if I go to one country, I will get coming back. I have like maybe like 10 to 20 new Facebook friend. So keep upgrading, and then so the project start like that. Like I offer them like accommodation, give a tour, and also like I put book.
This is not going to be
so short. I know.
So do more.
So the thing keep going on, like I have guests coming from like the not famous curator, now become super famous, not famous artist, now become super famous within these 10 years actually. It's really cool actually. And then also like a band from Indonesia that when I arrived here in 2004, not famous, just start a band, but now they are super famous in Southeast Asia. And then when they come to Malaysia, they say, first thing they say to their organizer, we want to meet Issa. And then the organizer say, who's the hell? What the hell? Who's this guy? And then it's not in the music scene at all. And I said, and then actually, it's good thing for me. Like, I don't have this kind of networking because the scene in Malaysia is very rigid. Like, you not hang out with the music people not hang out with the art people. So when like White Shoes and the Couple Company come, and then they said, we want to stay at Issa house, or they want to hang out with me. So I go out with them, and then I start to know these people like from music scene. And then actually I break the another layer of like the wall of like things. So I start to know people in Malaysia on the music scene. And then so when like, for example, like if I have an exhibition now, like people who come into my exhibition, not just people who are from the art scene. So we have like all people coming, like something like 500 people coming, and then we have band play and then friend, and then some people come to me, where you get all these kind of people? I say, yeah, this is all my friend. It's about the networking thing. And so what else? Yeah, and then I really enjoy hang out with people, meeting people, and then. But still have problem, like I want to be an artist, but for sure that I went to all the gallery in KL, everybody reject me. Say no, you are not commercial enough, and then actually make me like, I have to be creative. I don't know if it's creative or not, but I just have to find a way to survive actually. So I have to do works, like I have to do all the freelance work, like do everything. Even me and my friend have a company called FIB. Called fill in the blank. So we do anything to how to get money, and then we really work hard to get money just to do what we want. And then without I notice actually from this kind of freelance job, I start to know many people from the outside of the art world. Like I know the printer guy, I know this guy from freelance job, more on technical side. So at the end, this is a super friend now who helped me a lot. Like, I not depend on gallery or whatever. So because like all my exhibition that we organized by myself, like I have like, if I say I want to do a catalog, and then my printer coming to me like, yeah, I have the formula how to make a catalog cheaper. So we break all the company thing. For example, like he say like, if we buy the paper from different shop, go printing different shop, binding different shop, we cut half of the thing, and then I start to experiment with that, and I make a book of one of my projects, and we launch the book. And then many people coming to the exhibition say, how can you produce this book? It looks very good quality and expensive. And then people start to ask me like how to make a book. And then at that time in Malaysia, not many gallery produce a catalog because people think about the printing is expensive. So there's another way to get money. So me and my friend, we become the advisor for the gallery to make a catalog. So it takes me a few years. Like we make a catalog for the gallery, my designer do, my printing do, and then one day I'm super tired to do. And I say to my friend, the designer and the printer, say, okay, I give the company to you, but promise to me that you never mark up when I want to do a book because I have too much for me, and then so I have thing to do. So yeah, these people continue to do their thing, and then my latest project, I do book, and then it's still like halfway cheaper than the market thing. Yeah, and then what else? So the parking project, super friends keep coming, and then I have a lot of people like coming from different field coming to help me and everything. And then we have circle one parking project, circle two super friends, circle three. So it's depend, like if we want to organize a small party, maybe circle one coming. Or maybe like, okay, maybe we have more budget, okay, circle two, one and two. So and then after like 10 years like working in this field, and I just, because I meet in my journey, in my traveling, I meet many talented people, like people from, like I working in Taiwan last year, and I meet this lady, she's cute for sure. And then she's very good, like I'm working, she helped me a lot in the project, and then I just realized that her have a very good potential but for her to climb the stair, I know it's really difficult, it's not difficult, she will climb, but what can I help her? I think the only thing that I can help her is like by my networking. So when I got the offer to do residency in Bangkok this year, actually, early this year, and at that time I know that I get a little bit money from the artist fee, what I'm doing is I just email her, say, okay, what I can do is like I offer you a ticket to come to Bangkok, and then say like you come and help me to work, because I think that for sure you are cute, but also like you are good. We know how to work together. And then she really doubt about that kind of thing to come into Bangkok. And I told her actually, okay, we have to share everything, the room and everything. And then so actually at the end she's coming, and then the good thing is like she helped me a lot for the project. I know that I have very tense project, and then she helped me a lot. And then she told me that, oh, you can get people from Bangkok. I said, yeah, I can get people easily. I can set up new team in Bangkok. But I think like I'm more happy that if you come. So like, you know already, you've been through that, just how stupid I am when I do my project. So like, more easy for you to understand this time. And then, so for we do the project, and then it's quite successful. And then she's super sad and she want to go back, because like she start to feel about that. But it's really like this kind of opportunity is like very rare opportunity, and then it's too good to be true. Because like for me, like I want her to know people. She never been to Bangkok, like no people in Bangkok, no curator, no artist in Bangkok. So like that's the only thing that I can pay for her to get the new networking. That's how, even like for my Taiwan project, I asked my photographer, I said, okay, I can offer you only ticket, come to Taiwan with me. Because I know for that project, I really need very good photographer. But I know that with my camera, I cannot do that. So I just offer him to come, and then he come. For sure, he liked to travel. And then like, to go to London, maybe it's just normal. Go to London, but to go to Taipei or Taichung is, maybe it's, people not just planning to go there. And then, so when he coming, like he put like maybe 300% of his passion on photography to help me work for the thing. And then, so I got a very good result from the photography thing. And then he still now, after like 6 months, he keep talking to people about his experience in Taiwan. So For me, how I sharing this kind of thing is the best way that with my fluid organization called Parking Project actually. And then, so yeah, I keep getting like people come say, hey, can I help you? I say yeah for sure. I even say I cannot pay you, but how people like keep coming to help, and then people really happy with the title of super friend. That, I think that's the best thing, like yeah. Yeah, I think that's all.
Thank you. So yeah, here we are again. You know, we listen to this this experience, to this story. Yeah, the call for collaborative networking that has been mentioned by Mami earlier somehow has sort of like one answer, at least one model, one answer from Issei's presentation, how he started with really utilizing the available, the existing network, which are not exist in his own country, in back home, in KL, but there are already some activities going on around the region, and he even used the word hijacking the network. Yeah, he even like hijacked the network of Ruang Rupa to as a starting point, and then become bigger. And the interesting point is the fact that personal relationship or friendship seems to be the main drive of how Issei can maintain the whole his own artistic practice, his expansions of networks and other things. So again, two questions for this session, just two. Yeah, because we are sort of like running out of time. We still have two local artist initiatives based in Jogja. We'll do their presentations briefly. Okay, I think we'll skip the Q&A. We'll try to have much probably bigger comparison for. Thank you, Issei.